Hi! So, look around me. I'm still on the Joy Desk Resolution, but this time I am in what is known as the Micropaleontology Lab. This is where all the samples for micropaleontologic analysis are prepared as soon as they come out of the cores, and then scientists will take them under a microscope, evaluate what's present in this assemblage between microfossils, different types of microfossils, and with this, they're able to come up with a rough estimate of the age of deposition of the sediments that are being recovered. And this is a fitting place to be on the ship today because we're going to talk about chronostratigraphy. The term chronostratigraphy refers to time. That means that every chronostratigraphic unit needs to be a time unit. There are multiple ways of defining a chronostratigraphic unit because all you need is to find criteria that will basically give you a unit that is equal in time, unlike a lithostratigraphic unit, which is equal in the type of lithology. Today we're going to address two potential ways to go on reconstructing chronostratigraphic units. One is biostratigraphy, the other one is chemostratigraphy. The principle of biostratigraphy, which we'll start first, is that you can use faunal succession or organisms in sediments to reconstruct the timing of deposition of these sediments. Now, this is applicable to both marine sediments, like the ones we recover here on the JR, the Joy Desk Resolution, but also, of course, it's applicable to terrestrial sediments if you have a terrestrial faunal succession, for instance, mammals or things like that. The other thing is that the principle of biostratigraphy, of course, relies on a concept of evolution. You need evolution, you need rapid evolution to bring you new species of different organisms to be able to do chronostratigraphy using biostratigraphy. So these are fundamental concepts. But where did that science come from? What is the origin of biostratigraphy? So the father, if you want, of biostratigraphy, the oldest record of the fossil assemblages being used as a way to trace, to correlate rock, dates back to the end of the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th century. And it's a famous British scientist, William Smith, who came up with that concept. Now, William Smith was a surveyor, and his role was not to be a biostratigrapher, but as a surveyor for railway work in the UK, he was exposed to a lot of local rocks. One of the roles that William Smith had in his job as a surveyor was to draw maps, to be able to draw maps of the different rocks found when you build railway lines. And to do this, he looked at the rock content, and he noticed that the succession of strata in the south of England, where he was working, was predictable, that you always had the same different succession. So you had coal, then you had sand, and this pattern was repeated. So that allowed him to build the first geological map, one of which we actually have at Imperial College. But the other thing he noticed was that the succession of fauna, the different organisms within the strata, was also predictable. You always found the same faunal succession. And so he used the fossil content to basically draw his different strata. And this is the first known use of fossil content to do correlations. But notice that William Smith used fossil content and lithostratigraphy. He did not push this concept all the way to using only fossils. So in his mind, fossils were a useful tracer for lithology, but he didn't really separate lithostratigraphy from biostratigraphy. The man who will do this is Charles Lyell. Charles Lyell is credited with being the first one to use fossils alone for stratigraphic correlation. He worked in the Paris Basin, and in 1833, he noticed that in this particular basin, you could subdivide the rock record based on how much of the modern fauna you found. So he noticed that some of the rocks, the youngest one, contain about 90% of modern fauna. Some of the rocks contain only 18% of modern fauna, and the oldest rock in the Paris Basin that he found or worked on contained 9.5% of modern fauna. So he compared the fossil assemblages with the modern fauna that he found today in modern basins in Europe. And he termed these different epochs that he defined based on fossil the Eocene, the Pliocene, and the Miocene. Now, these terms, of course, are still in use today, even though the definition of these terms has changed. So he's the one who came up with those important terms that we still use in our stratigraphic chart. The other thing is that Charles Lyell's work was really fundamental in inspiring Charles Darwin's in his evolution theories. So for the first time with Charles Lyell's work, geologists were able to basically free themselves from the lithostratigraphic concept and realize that thanks to the fact that the fauna are changing over time, you could use the faunal assemblages to trace key events.